Yeah. joining us here at ISKCON Boston for this Sunday Feast program. I was scheduled to serve this class, but I was fortunate enough to know that my father, His Grace Syamacandra Prabhu, he decided to come over here to Boston. Syamacandra Prabhu is a disciple of His Holiness Bhakti Swarup Damodara Maharaj and has been into this movement for over 2 decades. And my brother and I, we've been very fortunate to be part of this family, headed by Syamacandra Prabhu and Sundari Mataji, my mother, because for all the training and all the wonderful Krishna conscious values that we talk about in classes, we were taught practically first and theoretically next. Generally we hear about them in classes and then we experience them in life. But we were very, very fortunate that from our crawling stage, from the time practically I started to crawl, he was instrumental in taking us to the ISKCON temple in Mumbai. And every weekend, we were so much used to this program that every Sunday morning, it was a routine that we had to go to the temple. And he used to tell us that when you're giving 5 days of the week for yourself, can't you give 5 hours on a Sunday morning for Krishna? So, giving us japa beads, teaching us how to chant, holding our hands and taking us to the temple and teaching us how to sing. Right from the time I got the first mridanga in my life, from the time I got the first time I went to the dham, the holy pastime places of the Lord, He's been very instrumental. So this class, which I was supposed to serve, I would humbly request him to speak, and would also humbly request all of us, all of you, to welcome him by loudly saying Hari Bol. Hari Bol!
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. I think that was a bit of exaggeration as far as I am concerned. In being too lavish, probably it's a son's love for father. I can see that now. Well, honestly, I have only done my duty as any other parent would do, and very fortunate that I got the shelter of His Holiness Bhakti Swarup Damodara Swami Maharaj, one of the foremost disciples of Srila Prabhupada, the founder of the movement. And he appeared at a time when the world is undergoing a transition in the thought process, transition in the technology, and transition in the way we look at things around us. So Srila Prabhupada empowered Sripad Maharaj, as he is fondly called, to convey or preach in a scientific manner. Because today, if a scientist says, yes, I believe in it, then the world says, yes, I believe in it. If the scientists say, well, it is an hypothesis, it is yet to be proven, then the world also reacts accordingly. So it's a challenge to present the scriptures in a scientific manner and to convince people like Nobel laureates and having interactions with them on a regular basis and then having the dialogue. So I was fortunate in that respect. So I'm sorry if I'm stealing his thunder today, Amarnath's thunder, because he was supposed to give the class. But I wanted to thank all of you for coming here, and I will try to read some words and also share the purport and what is understanding as conveyed by Srila Prabhupada, so that we all are on the same level of understanding this verse, because this is a very popular and I would say a forceful verse in our lives, because it can transform our lives. So I would read from this Bhagavad Gita chapter 5, that is Karma Yoga, action in Krishna consciousness, and the verse is 29. Before reading the verse, let's recite this. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 The verse is Bhoktaram Yakya Tapasam Sarva Loka Maheshwaram Surdam Sarva Bhutanam Nantamam Shantim Rachati. Translation: a person in full consciousness of me, knowing me to be the ultimate beneficiary of all sacrifices and austerities, the Supreme Lord of all planets and demigods, and the benefactor and well-wisher of all living beings, attains peace from the pangs of material miseries. Translation by, purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. The conditioned souls within the clutches of the illusionary energy are all anxious to attain peace in the material world, but they do not know the formula for peace, which is explained in this part of the Bhagavad Gita. The greatest peace formula is simply this: Lord Krishna is the beneficiary in all human activities. Men should offer everything to the transcendental service of the Lord, because He is the proprietor of all planets and the demigods thereon. No one is greater than He. He is greater than the greatest of the demigods, Lord Shiva and Lord Brahma. In the Vedas, the Supreme Lord is described as Tam Ishwaranam Paramam Maheshwaram. Under the spell of illusion, living entities are trying to be lords of all they survey, but actually they are dominated by the material energy of the Lord. The Lord is the master of the material nature, and the conditioned souls are under the stringent rules of material nature. Unless one understands these bare facts, it is not possible to achieve peace in the world, either individually or collectively. This is the sense of Krishna consciousness. Lord Krishna is the supreme denominator, and all living entities, including the great demigods, are His subordinates. One can attain perfect peace only in complete Krishna consciousness. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnana Anjana Salakya Chakshuranmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Kadadar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Okay, once again, Hare Krishna to all. How many of you are coming here for the first time? One. Okay. So I have some company. I was thinking whether I'm the only one coming here for the first time, but thanks. Well, so one of the most important things that we all try to aim for in our life is happiness. Is it not? We all aim for happiness. Only thing is we see different means to get happiness. Some feel that acquiring wealth is a means to get happiness. Some feel maybe acquiring knowledge is a means to get happiness. And some feel, you know, acting immorally or, snatching away something is a means to get happiness. I mean, there are different classes of people who approach world in a different way to get happiness. But the point is, are we getting the peace? You know, here in this verse, clearly it is explained what is the peace formula. As Srila Prabhupada says, it's a peace formula. That means it's not possible to get peace or happiness inside unless we understand the truth. You know, it is not confidential, it is a revealed one. But unless we understand it, and it's a knowledge, so we understand this knowledge and then we imbibe and lead the life in that way, then definitely it's scientific. So this is a hypothesis. Let's try it out. And there are realized souls who have said, yes, there is happiness. So primarily, why are we going after this happiness and peace? Okay, the real thing is that this is a planet. Okay, it's a planet full of miseries. Okay, there is no escape from birth, old age, disease and death. No one can escape these things. We feel that, okay, you know, there's some sorrow in the family, it's okay, I'll tide over that, maybe later on I'll get happiness. So we are trying to search for, you know, water in the mirage, and you never get that. Now you keep on searching and it sees, oh, if I go further, I see there is water there. And we keep on chasing and our life, it gets over in this. So maybe we want to, you know, when a child is born, the parents try to give the academic knowledge, okay, which they think that by having a suitable academic knowledge, the child, when he grows up, will have a good job. Okay, then they push him that, okay, you must have a good job so that you can have a lot of wealth, good house, a car, a good wife. So the civilization is directing us towards that. It's basically a race in which we are caught into. Okay, and at the end of our, when we come to retirement life, what have we achieved? Whatever we have saved, you know, we are just transferring to the next generation. And then we realize probably I should have led life in a different way. But we don't know what is that way. So here it is clearly explained. Okay, now why do living beings, you know, have this propensity to get misdirected? Because we have to understand how the energies of the Lord are, you know, what are the energies of the Lord? So Lord has primarily three energies. One is the internal potency, Antaranga Shakti, as we say. Other one is the Bahiranga Shakti, that's external. And then there is something in middle, that is marginal or Tathastha Shakti. So these living beings are actually marginal energy of the Lord. So by virtue of being marginal, they are in the boundary. You know, if they go this way, they are getting attracted to the Lord. If they go this way, they get attracted to the material energy, which is also called as Maya. Maya means basically it's a secretary of the Lord, which prevents you from going to the Lord. So it gives you all the attractions which are illusionary, and we get caught in those attractions. So primarily, because human beings are marginal, we tend to sway this way and that way. Okay. So when the internal energy of the Lord, you are under the control of the internal energy of the Lord, then you tend to do service to the Lord, because then you want to hear only all things about Lord, and all your activities will be revolving around Lord. But when you are under the spell of the material energy, then you tend to do sense gratification activities, because these senses are all material. Our body is material, but we are not material. We are actually soul, which is Atma. And Atma is the part and parcel of Paramatma, which is Supreme Personality of the Godhead. So primarily what we are trying to do is we are trying to find happiness through body senses, which we are going to, you know, leave behind. You know, normally if you ask anybody, how will you define happiness? So the answer would be, happiness is a state of mind. Okay, it is not guaranteed that Bill Gates, who is the richest man in the planet with $80 billion worth of assets, is the most happiest man. If you ask him, you know, there might be so many, you know, problems with him. At the same time, you might well see that somebody who is not rich, or you know, maybe a poor man, he may be quite happy as well. So why is it different? Even though on the bodily platform, okay, there is rich and there is a poor, because happiness is a state of mind, and mind is subtle. Mind is not gross. Can we see mind? Gross? We cannot. Mind is subtle. But when a person dies or leaves his body, the mind goes along with the soul. Mind, intelligence and ego, the subtle body goes along with the soul. And that impression is then carried forward to the next life. Okay, this is what the scriptures say. So in this formula, actually if you see, Krishna explains in very simple terms, what is the way to get happiness. So if you see this, it is primarily broken down into, it's a three-pronged formula. Okay, I'll break this verse. The first formula is Bhoktaram Yaga Tapasam. Okay, and the second one is Sarvaloka Maheshwaram, and the third one is Suvirtam Sarva Bhutanam. Okay, so that way the sloka can be broken down into three parts, and each part actually is by a formula by itself. Now primarily if you see Bhoktaram Yaga Tapasam, the sloka says that Bhoktaram, okay, it means that the beneficiary, Bhoktaram Yaga Tapasam, of all sacrifices and penances or tapasas, who is that? That is Lord Krishna. That means, what do these people who are non-Krishna consciousness but so-called Karmakandas, you know, they worship the various demigods. You know, if you worship the goddess of fortune, you are supposed to get wealth. If you worship Saraswati, you are supposed to get knowledge. Lord Ganesha, you are supposed to get intelligence. But who is the beneficiary of all that? It's an indirect worship of the Lord. And the Lord does not like that. Okay, so actually we are disappointing him, and we are annoying him in the process. We feel that by worshipping the demigods, we are achieving our short-term goals. But it is actually an insult to the Lord in one sense. Prabhupada gives an example of if you want to water the tree, would you water the branches and the leaves, or would you water the roots? Obviously the answer is you will water the roots, because the roots provide all the nutrients and everything to the branches and twigs. I would be the biggest fool on earth if I am going to water each and every leaves in the tree. So this is exactly the same thing. Karmakandis, they do that. They worship all the demigods. And that also, they don't know how many demigods are there. As per the scriptures, there are 33 crores demigods. But we don't even know them. So you would end up worshipping only 5 or 6. And at the end of it, you are disappointing the remaining. So that's not going to be giving you peace at all. The second thing is Sarvaloka Maheshwaram. So Lord Krishna further reaffirms why he has to be worshipped. Because he says he is the Sarvaloka Maheshwaram. Sarvaloka means what? All planets. All planets means not only the material planets, even the spiritual planets. That means in the material realm, Lord Brahma is the topmost planet, Brahma Loka. Okay, beyond that, there is Lord Shiva's planet, then Vaikuntha, then Goloka. So here, Lord Krishna reaffirms I am Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. Okay? Of all the planets, of all the demigods, Maheshwaram, Mahaishwaram. Okay? Parameshwaram, Mahaishwaram. So, there is nobody equal to or bigger than me. He is reaffirming that. So, that's the second thing we have to understand. And the third thing is, yeah, so before we go to the third thing, by reaffirming what he is saying is that he is alone the proprietor, okay, of all the worlds. He is alone the proprietor. There's nobody else of all the planets and of the all the demigods. He is a proprietor. So it's like, I mean, Bill Gates is a proprietor of his company, Microsoft. He is a controller of his company. But is he the proprietor of General Motors? Certainly not. I mean, if he claims that, General Motors will, give it back to him. Okay, you might be the richest planet on, richest man in the planet, but you have got nothing to do with General Motors. So the only person is Lord Krishna who can claim that I am the proprietor of all living beings, of all planets, of all demigods, everything. Okay, so here basically that's a reaffirmation. And the third thing is Suirdam Sarva Bhutanam. Now Suirdam Sarva Bhutanam is I am the well-wisher. He says I am the well-wisher of all living entities. Now this is equivalent to a relationship between a father and son. Okay, the father and son's father is the only person in the world who is a well-wisher for his son. The son may forget the father's good deeds because he grows and then he may forget, but the father will always remember right from childhood how he has brought up the child. So it's exactly the same. Lord is our well-wisher. Not only our well-wisher, he's a well-wisher of all living beings. So he's again reaffirming that I am the Suirdam Sarva Bhutanam. So I am the well-wisher of all the living beings. So now, if you understand these three-pronged formula, Jai Bola Shri Shri Radha Gopi Vallabha Ki Jai, Shri Shri Gauratai Ki Jai, Jagannath Bhante Subhadramai Ki Jai, Shri Prabhupad Ki Jai. So once we understand this, then what is the difficulty in completely surrendering to the Lord? What is the difficulty? The thing is, why do we have this propensity, okay, to enjoy independently? If I have to draw an analogy here, let's say you work for a company, okay, and you have been given certain tasks to carry out your duties and responsibilities by your superior or your boss. Now if you do those duties and tasks to his satisfaction, he's going to be very happy with you, he's going to be pleased with you, is it not? Right? And what does he do if he is pleased with you? He is going to award you with a promotion. Okay, maybe better increment in the salary. And maybe higher responsibilities. So higher responsibilities come because you have proven yourself in the previous responsibility assigned to you. You are a capable person. On the other hand, okay, if I have my own agenda, okay, the boss might be telling me something to do, but I have my own agenda. And I do it in my own way, what will happen? Probably that will be the end of my tenure in the company. Okay, or I might be demoted. Because you are not carrying out the responsibilities and duties as per the expectations. The expectation is important thing, you know. Because you cannot just carry out as per your whims and fancies. There are roles and responsibilities defined to you. So this is exactly the situation in our life. We have been actually kicked out, okay, because we wanted to enjoy independent of the Lord. Okay, he says, go to this earth planet, enjoy as much as you want, okay, and then be with it. Further you fall down or whatever it is, you face it. And then we know in earth what are the difficulties, especially in Kali Yuga. Now we are in the beginning of Kali Yuga, only 5,000 years, and we are already seeing how difficult it is to, practice spirituality. The moment you talk of spirituality outside, oh, this person, you know, he's talking like a retired man. Let's enjoy our life. Come on. This is to be, you know, for our grandparents, when we reach that age, we should practice spirituality. And at that age, grandparents, oh, I can't hear properly. Can you read this verse for me? Can you, you know, translate this for me? Can you give me a new pair of glasses with a higher number? All these problems associated, I cannot sit for a long time, my back is paining. All these problems are there. Oh, probably I should have started Krishna consciousness at a much, you know, younger age. But you have lost, your life is over. Then again you get a chance in the next life. So this is the, you know, tragedy we are all actually encountering. So it's lucky are those who are exposed to this knowledge at a very young age and understand that this is basically a third dimension to our life. You have to definitely be educated. You cannot be an uneducated person. You have to be educated because we have a material body. We have to have a, you know, we have to fulfill the requirements of the material needs. But we have to understand what for we are doing all this. What is the purpose? What is the goal behind it? Is it only to satisfy our senses and then, you know, get more and more sucked into it? Certainly not. So we have to dovetail our activities. You know, whatever activities you do, you keep Krishna in the center. That is Krishna consciousness. You keep Krishna as a, make Krishna as your beneficiary. Don't take any, you know, rewards. If you get a reward from a company, okay, thanks to Krishna. Okay, so if you keep Krishna in the center, then you are practicing attachment and detachment simultaneously. Attachment to the Lord and detachment to your activities. Because these activities are material activities, you are going to leave it the day you quit your body. So therefore, if we practice this, you know, we will be in a situation that when we leave our body, okay, we will be properly situated even in the mind. Because Krishna says at the time you quit your body, whatever state of mind you are in, that is your next body. So if you think of me, you come to me. He says very clearly. So this cannot be an examination which can be passed without preparation. Isn't it? The normal examination itself, we struggle, but somehow we pass. Because we studied the last minute, last 1 month we studied, we rectified, as we say in Bombay. Okay? And then we pass. But this is not that kind of an examination. This is a serious examination because there is competition here. There is heavy competition. And you have to be among the best to succeed. Otherwise, again, you have to repeat. You get a chance next time, next life again. Oh, again, no, again, next life. So are you prepared for that? Or are you want to, you know, having understood with knowledge, you want to now say goodbye to all these things and then Hari Bol and enter into spiritual kingdom and then only bliss and bliss, ananda, ananda. So the wise is he who understands this at an early age and practices and preaches. Because practicing is for self, preaching is for helping others. That is what Srila Prabhupada did. That is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did when he came. Why did he do all this? Because he wanted to help the humanity. Teach them how to love God. So love God, that is the essence. And if we love God, then we go back to him. Then we, if you love your parent, you'll know what your parent likes. You will not do things which disappoint your parent. So exactly the same. Whatever we are doing in our material life, it is just a perverted reflection of what we are supposed to do in the spiritual life. Talking of enjoying propensity, there is one character in Mahabharata whom we are all familiar with the name, that is Shishupal. Isn't it? All of us have heard that name Shishupal. He is also known as the embodiment of envy. Embodiment of envy because he is one unique person who since birth had no other agenda but only to abuse the Lord. Normally when a child is born, the first thing the child automatically learns is to call mother's name, mama, papa, you know, these are things. But Shishupal was one person who only spoke about ill about the Lord right from childhood. And his mother had actually warned him, don't do this beta, I mean this is not good. And she knew that if he continues this way, a day will come when the Lord will finish him. So the Lord was so merciful that he gave him 100 times that you can abuse me. Look at his mercy. 100 times you abuse me, but beyond that I will not tolerate. I mean, Lord is so merciful, isn't it? So then 99 over, and the 100th time it happened in the Mahasabha where Yudhishthira Maharaj was performing an yajna. So there again Shishupal started abusing the Lord. So the Lord said, okay, your time is up. Okay, and he just pulled out his Sudarshan Chakra and then let it out on him, and the head was completely detached. So this is basically the propensity of enviousness. We may say in what is the relevance to us, because we are not Shishupal, we are not abusing the Lord, but we are mini Shishupals. That's a fact, we are mini Shishupals, because we may not be abusing the Lord, but then we are enjoying independent of the Lord. That also is a Shishupal nature. Okay, so we should realize that our only goal here is enjoyment in relation to Krishna. That means you get enjoyment or pleasure out of serving the Lord. So if the Lord is happy, automatically you are pleased. You don't have to independently search for happiness. There is one more narration in the Srimad Bhagavatam where Lord shows his reciprocation to the devotees, you know, especially gopis who are very much caring for him. Once the great sage Narada went to the Lord in Vrindavan, and the Lord was experiencing an acute headache. So he said, I'm having headache, I don't know what to do. So Narada said, how can I help you? So the Lord said that it is only possible if I can have the dust of the lotus feet of my devotee. So would you like to give me some dust from your lotus feet? So Narada was Lord Narada was suddenly bewildered, because he knows from my feet the dust, if I give to the Lord, I will go to hell. How can I do that? I cannot go to hell. So he said, okay, let me find some devotees who can agree for this. So he goes to search. Then he meets the gopis and he asks gopis this question, and to his astonishment, the gopis readily agreed to give the dust from their lotus feet, and buckets and buckets of the dust was collected. So Narada asked these devotees, "Arey, what are you doing? Don't you know that if you do this, you will go to hell?" What was the gopis' reply? "We don't mind going to the hell. We just don't mind. If the Lord is relieved of his headache at the expense of we going to the hell, be it that way. We are perfectly okay, no problem at all." So this is the mood of the devotees. This is the mood of devotees, and the Lord reciprocates to them. So Lord knows, it's not that Lord is going to send them to hell. It's just a test. Who is a real devotee? Srila Prabhupada explains one example. This typical human propensity. This is a very common example. I'm sure some of you must have read it and heard it also. If you find $100 note kept beside you, and there is nobody else claiming making a claim for that, there are three possibilities that can arise out of that situation. The easiest possibility, as most of us, non-devotees, not us, most of us would do, is that pick up the note and put it in the pocket. There's nobody else to see. Who is there to see? Note pada hai, let me take it and put it inside. In any case, it does not belong to anybody, because if it belonged to somebody, he would have come and taken it. So it's lying there, why not I put it in my pocket? So this is actually not a good possibility. The second possibility is I negate it. Negate it meaning what? I see the note, but I will not touch it. I will say that, okay, it does not belong to me, but I will not touch it also. That is like, tyag. I don't want to touch it. But somewhere inside, I will feel this way that I am not touching it, but somebody else will come and touch it. So that is not giving me peace of mind. So the first case, I took the money, but I am feeling a guilt inside. It is not giving me peace. The second case, I am negating it. That is also not giving me peace, because somebody else will come and take it. Then what? So this also is ruled out. So the third possibility, which is I pick up the note and give it to the right owner. I have to find who is the right owner. If I do that, I am pleasing him because he is the owner of the note, and because I give it back to him, I am also pleased. So this is exactly the situation where we are in. We need to find out who is the proprietor of everything. That Krishna has explained in this work, this verse, there is no argument about it. So everything, anything that we do must be dovetailed and connected to the Lord. So finally, how do we please the Lord? So the Lord is pleased, because ultimately we are talking of happiness here, isn't it? So how do we please the Lord? The Lord can be pleased through bhakti process, bhakti yoga. I mean, jnana yoga, dhyana yoga, karma yoga, all those things will ultimately lead to bhakti yoga. They are slow process, steps. Bhakti yoga is the lift process. So in bhakti yoga, there are 9 processes as defined by Prahlad Maharaj. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Sparanam, Padasevanam, Archana, Mandanam, Dasyam, Sakyam, Atma Nivedanam. So by executing this 9 process, okay, we are able to please the Lord. So that's the reason the devotees all the time chant, the devotees all the time sing in glories of the Lord. We do Nagar Sankirtan, we try to give the love of God message to all, we do Archana, we do Vandanam, we pay respective obeisance to all the Vaishnavas and devotees and Acharyas and everybody else, because we are crying for mercy. Ultimately, we are crying for mercy. We are not selfish. We are not thinking that if we do this, we get this in return. No, that is selfish mentality. We do this unconditional. This is called unalloyed devotional service. Period. It's unconditional, unalloyed. If Goddess of Fortune, Mahalakshmi Devi, is massaging the lotus feet of Lord Narayan, okay, that is unconditional, her love for Lord Narayan. If Mother Yashoda is tying Damodar around his belly, this is Damodar month of course, it's out of love. It is not a punishment, it's love. So if you take Lakshmi Devi, okay, Goddess of Fortune, and connect Lakshmi Devi to Lord Narayan, both are happy. Lakshmi also is happy, Narayan also is happy, and if both are happy, you are also happy. That's why in this month, especially, which we call as Kartik month or Damodar month, one devotee tries to acquire maximum punya. And punya is acquired through charity. So this is a month when if you try to give some Lakshmi for the purpose of Lord Narayan, rest assured, she will give you back in multiples. Again, to test you, whether you are falling a prey. If you fall a prey, that's Maya. If you not fall a prey, then that is Krishna. Krishna Prem. Talking of Sarvaloka Maheshwaram, okay, there is always doubt, you know. This doubt is not only at human being level, but even at Lord Brahma's level. I mean, Brahma, the creator, okay, Brahma Loka, you know, it's highest planet in the material universe. So once when he went to meet the Lord, he was stopped at the gate. The Lord is, taking rest, so you cannot come now. So Brahma says, what? I am Brahma. Please tell the Lord, Brahma has come. So that gatekeeper goes and says that Brahma has come. So the Lord tells the gatekeeper to ask him which Brahma has come. So the gatekeeper comes and tells him. So Brahma is bewildered. Then finally he gets an entry somehow. And for whatever purpose he came, that is being done. But towards the end, Brahma did ask this question to the Lord. My dear Lord, I have this question. Why did you ask the gatekeeper to ask me this question, which Brahma? I thought I am the only Brahma. So what did the Lord do? The Lord from his mind created several Brahmas right in front of him. right in front of him. He created more headed Brahmas, 10 headed Brahmas, 100 headed Brahmas, 1000 headed Brahmas, 10,000 head Brahmas, 1 million head Brahmas. So our Brahma suddenly became minuscule in front of them, and he realized what is there, what is his position in relation to the other Brahmas. So we cannot, you know, even contemplate what is the position, if you know, in front of the Lord. So therefore, when Lord says Sarva Loka Maheshwaram, take it in the face value. There is nobody equal or higher. So he stands to be the controller and the proprietor. The see, quite often we say that the Lord is situated in the heart, correct? And so if we situate in the heart, how do we realize that? Okay, we know Lord is situated in the heart because he says that in 18.61, Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam Riddheshu Arjuna Tishtati. That means I am seated in the heart of every living being. So the heart has to be completely cleansed. If you clean the mirror of the heart, Cheto Darpanam Arjanam, then you can see and feel the heart. It is exactly like last week I was flying from Chicago to Guadalajara in Mexico. It was an afternoon flight. When I took off, nice bright sunshine, beautiful, nice rays of the sun and all nice blue skies. And suddenly before landing in Guadalajara, okay, as the flight is descending down, there is a very thick and dark clouds, okay, and the aircraft with a little bit of turbulence somehow comes down. And when it completely comes down, what do I see? Just gloomy land and almost dark, you know, evening. Whereas above the clouds, it was pure radiation of sunshine. So the people downstairs, as we say, do not know how the upstairs looks like. This is exactly the position here. Exactly, this is the position. I was immediately, when I saw that, I was thinking that we are not able to realize how the Lord is situated here and what is the process for cleansing the heart. Because if I cleanse the heart, then I can see the radiation coming from Paramatma. The Paramatma is there to guide everyone. Otherwise you tell me, how does the cat know that the rat is the food for the cat? There is a Paramatma guidance for the cat also. There is a Paramatma guidance for the crocodile that it can distinguish between a prey and its own child. So therefore, the same jaw which is love for the child becomes a crusher for a prey, because it's a Paramatma that is guiding it. So the Paramatma is sitting here, and it's basically we need to understand, realize it, and then we need to achieve. So basically, we as human beings are not utilizing this intelligence. Animals have got the intelligence, even though they don't have any karmic effects. We have karmic effects. We are supposed to utilize higher intelligence, but we are not utilizing it. We have become so mean that we think, oh, my future is insecure, so let me save more, let me store more. I mean, there's a famous example of the grains. If the grains are, you know, if you keep a sack of grains, the pigeons will come, whatever they want to pick up, they'll pick up, eat and go. Similarly, other birds also. When the man comes, he will think, oh, there is one grain, one sack, two sack. He will take one for himself, then he will take another two, and he will stop, because it's a question of tomorrow. So this is our actually, you know, mentality. We don't actually try to understand that these basic principles of the nature of life applies to us more than anybody else in the world. So if we accept this three-pronged peace formula, Bhoktaram Yaga Tapasam, Sarva Loka Maheshwaram, Suirdam Sarva Bhutanam, Nyantavam Shantim Rachate. Okay. If we understand these three formulas of the life, this we call as the peace formula, then we can achieve collective peace as well as individual peace. Okay, there is nothing that will disturb us. There might be, we might be inflicted by the threefold miseries because that is part of the material nature, but we will take it in the perspective. We will not be bewildered, we will not be disturbed, because we know this is already there in this material nature. Adi Daivik, Adi Bhautik and Adhyatmik. So, I would like to end my my short stint here on this note, that if you love God, you will love all living beings. You cannot be selective, as some religion propagate that there is no soul in animals, or there is, you know, these are all creation for the benefit of human being. If you love, then you will love every living being, because in everything there is Paramatma. So therefore, if you do that, then compassion will come automatically. And once compassion comes, then you will start developing the habit of peaceful living, simple living, high thinking, and that will be the secret formula to get happiness. So with that, I end here, and I thank you very much for your kind participation. And if there is something that was not expressed properly, I'm sorry for that, but I tried my best to express whatever is given here in the this particular sloka. So Hare Krishna, thank you very much.
So a couple of points before we stop for the day. Since the topic of peace was conveyed, in this month, can we have the door closed, please? Hare Krishna. So in this month of Kartik, is filled with festivals. Festivals like the appearance of Radhakund, called as Bahulashtami. Festivals like Diwali, which is next week. Festivals like Govardhan Puja, where Krishna lifted the Govardhan hill. And finally, towards the end of this month, the most glorious departure of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. So every festival in this month is attempting to teach us the same principle of how to find peace of mind and not pieces of our mind. Let's have our mind in peace and not in pieces. And the best way that we could have that done in this age of Kali Yuga is by the process of hearing about Krishna and collectively chanting about Krishna. I didn't think I sounded that terrible. So Srila Prabhupada had sent us like this setup, only so that wonderful Vaishnavas like all of y'all assembled here on a Sunday evening, when you could have done so many other things, gone out with your family, gone out with your friends, or done so many other things, but you prefer to spend that Sunday evening so lovingly and so nicely with big smiles on all your faces here in the temple, already all set to offer ghee lamps to the Lord and chant in here in proper devotion. So let's hope and let's pray that this month brings in more auspiciousness, not just materially, but actually gets in inner fulfillment, helps us blossom within, and let our devotion and faith in the process of Sri Krishna's bhakti increase step by step. So now let's stop, and then we have Damodarashtra, right?
Stand on the right-hand side.
Okay. So we're going to have Damodarashtaka now, where we're going to offer ghee lamps to the form of Yashoda and Damodar. So as per Nitin Prabhu's order, we're going to have lines set up this way to the right side of the temple. We're going to line up so that we could offer ghee lamps one after the other. So thank you so much for coming in, and Hare Krishna. No, it's the same. Srila Prabhupada ki.
Jai.